Good morning, everybody, and welcome to the 24th meeting of the Education and Culture Committee in 2015. Can I remind everybody that they must have their phones and electronic devices switched off. They can and sometimes do interfere with the sound system, so preferably if they were off, but at the very least have them on silent. First of all, I've got apologies from John Pentland, MSP, who can't be here today, and Liam MacArthur, who is trying to be here today but is having the usual problems with his flights from Orkney. If it helps, could we, on behalf of the committee, say whoever provides the flights from Orkney, could they help out Liam MacArthur and get him here more often? But Liam is trying to get here. He may not make it, but I know that he's annoyed by that. He's only not here because of his flight problems. The first item is for us to decide whether to take items 3 and 4 in private. Are members agreed? Agreed, thank you. Our next item is an evidence session on Education Scotland, continuing our work on examining the spending decisions and the outcomes delivered by some of the key bodies within our remit. Can I welcome to the committee Dr. Bill Maxwell and Alastair Delaney. Welcome to you both this morning. And I believe, Bill, have you got some opening remarks you want to make?
I do. Thank you, convener. Can I start by saying that we very warmly welcome this opportunity to meet with the members of the Education and Culture Committee today to engage in discussion about our recent work and the emerging priorities for the period ahead. I hope today's discussion will give us the opportunity to set out some of the detail of the exciting and innovative work that Education Scotland is carrying out to contribute to improving Scottish education and the achievement of Scotland's collective national ambition for education. That's the ambition to ensure that Scottish education achieves excellence with equity for all learners, regardless of their individual needs and their social background, and that public confidence in education is high. I believe the creation of Education Scotland in July 2011 was a bold and progressive step that has given us a unique form of national improvement agency, one that's able to capitalise on powerful synergies between evaluation, development and support functions, which were previously provided by a range of separate bodies in less clearly integrated and coherent ways. It's a model of improvement agency that I think is particularly well suited to be helping our education system make the transition from being a good system to being one which is truly great. An agency which in many ways you can say reflects the what's increasingly becoming known as the Scottish approach to public service improvement. The range of core functions that we provide can perhaps most easily be summarised in terms of our five main outward-facing strategic objectives, each of which represent a key area of our work. So firstly, we provide national leadership for development and support of the curriculum, including learning, teaching and assessment practice, most obviously through our lead on the implementation of Curriculum for Excellence, but also through leading on the development of national guidance in other areas such as adult learning, for example, or community learning and development practice. Secondly, we play a national role in promoting high-quality professional learning and leadership amongst education practitioners, providing resources, facilities and professional learning opportunities on a broad front. Thirdly, building on Scotland's impressive tradition of promoting self-evaluation and improvement in education, we undertake a whole variety of activities designed to enhance the capacity of frontline education providers to drive continuous improvement in their own performance. That ranges from the more obvious, such as our How Good Is Our Family of toolkits for self-evaluation, How Good Is Our School, etc., to the more subtle, such as the experience gained by serving practitioners who join us and work alongside inspectors as we look at practice out with their own areas. Then fourthly, we continue to place a strong focus on providing independent professional evaluation of the quality of education across Scotland through our programmes of establishment and service inspections and through national thematic reviews. This continues to be crucial in providing assurance and in providing a strong basis of evidence which we can use to promote the spread of effective practice across the system. And then finally, drawing on our uniquely rich evidence base that inspections and all our other work give us, we have a crucial role in providing ministers with policy and policy colleagues and other national bodies indeed with high quality professional advice to feed into their decisions and their policy making. These five functions are distinct, but they're interdependent, and they can complement each other powerfully if we plan and manage them well. We aim to provide a balanced blend of all five functions to support the improvement of quality education at every stage, from the early years through to lifelong learning, working in collaboration with partners appropriate to the sector. And having all of these functions within the one organisation, we can strategically shift our resources and our priorities to suit the current needs in any sector or at any point in time. Over the last 4 years, I believe that certainly enabled us to play a more effective role in driving the implementation of key programmes of reform and driving improvement across all the areas in which we work. Of course, in recent times, we've made a huge commitment in particular to supporting the implementation of Curriculum for Excellence through a key phase in its development, as CFE has become more increasingly embedded across the early phase in the broad general education, and as the first new national qualifications were delivered to pupils and students in the senior phase across Scotland. But there are many other initiatives in which our teams have played an equally important role in close alignment with Curriculum for Excellence work. We've worked extensively, for example, on the Developing Young Workforce programme with a focus on improving work experience, career education, and generally improving more coherent vocational pathways into employment through the senior phase and beyond. And I believe that our contribution to informing the development of policy continues to grow. Looking beyond CFE, Teaching Scotland's Future and Developing the Young Workforce, there are many other examples I could cite from our role in developing and implementing the new youth strategy, the adult learning statement of ambition, to more specific areas like Gaelic education, Scots language, and contributing to ministerial subgroups on child sexual exploitation. And we continue to respond, of course, to sometimes rapid changes in the policy landscape. Indeed, in the last year, we've been closely involved in two major new initiatives announced through the last two programmes for government, both designed to achieve a decisive move towards breaking the link between social background and poverty and attainment, which has been a persistent feature of our education system for far too long. We're working in close partnership with our policy colleagues in Learning Directorate to take forward the Scottish Attainment Challenge and the National Improvement Framework. These are key priority areas for our work and will be for some time ahead, because the issue they are addressing is one of the defining challenges of our age, how to ensure that all learners in Scotland can achieve their full potential regardless of their social circumstances. So with all that in mind, today's committee session comes at a good time for us, as we are beginning now to look forward to the conclusion of our first 3-year strategic planning cycle, and we're about to start a process of wide consultation about our strategic direction for the 3 years beyond 2016. So it does feel particularly timely to be meeting with the committee to engage in dialogue about our contribution thus far and about the sort of priorities we'll be focusing on going forward. So thanks again for the invitation, and I look forward to responding to questions the committee wishes to raise.
Yeah, thank you very much, Bill. A lot of stuff in there and a lot of stuff in your submission that you sent in, so thank you for that. I'm just going to go straight to members now for questions, and I'm going to start with Chick Brodie.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. And I have to apologise, I have to nip out and then come back into the committee at about 10:30. I wonder if I can ask about the organisational sector after the merger. In your submission, there was mention that when ES was created in July 2011 through the various mergers, it found then it sits within the Director General of Learning and Justice portfolio. Why is that? Why was that decided that it should sit within that? Why not direct communication? I know you will have direct communication with the ministers, but what role does the Director General of Learning and Justice play in terms of your organisation?
Yeah, we certainly do have direct lines of accountability to the minister as an executive agency, which was the constitutional position that was decided best suited Education Scotland. It was also, I have to say, exactly the same structure. Yes, we did input to discussion around that. Ultimately, it's a ministerial decision, but we did discuss that. It's exactly the same relationship, I have to say, that HM Inspectorate of Education had prior to the merger, also with the same relationship to the Director General of Learning Justice, for example. There's a rather arcane title called the Fraser figure, which is technically the role that the Director General Learning and Justice plays in relation to the agency. So we engage with that family of policy directorates to help keep alignment with policy and to help make sure our advice is also going in where it can do most use. But ultimately, The Director General has a role. It's laid out in our framework document in quite clear terms, but the Director General has a role in advising ministers on whether the work that we, I, are proposing to do is aligned, in his view, with the priorities of ministers and of the policy department.
Forgive me, I don't understand. I mean, in terms of, we talked about the Fraser figure, it sounds more like Corporal Fraser than anybody else. I mean, you have a huge role in promoting education in Scotland. Why does it need to have a conduit through the Director General of Learning and his portfolio?
Well, I would say all public bodies are sponsored through portfolios of one Director General or another. The executive agency status just means that we are, in a sense, more closely part of the family than a typical NDPB would be, although they are, like SQA or SFC, they are nonetheless accountable through a Director General, but in a different way. The executive agency link with the Fraser figure role, from my point of view, means I think that we are better connected and better plugged in to the development of policy at an early stage within government, and the ability to play our role in feeding evidence into that process.
But that's the point. You're feeding evidence in through another channel to the minister. Again, a caveat is, I've no doubt you meet the cabinet secretary and the minister quite often. But what we will want to understand is who calls the shots in terms of, you know, for example, the framework document 2012 said that Education Scotland will increase the pace of improvement across the whole of our education system. This additional link, how does that actually add value to what you're trying to achieve?
It is always helpful for us to be closely aligned with government policy. I think we, as you say, we have close and regular links with ministers directly. There's no sense in which the membership of being part of the family of the DG gets in the way of that. In fact, on the contrary, I think it can be quite supportive to have a clear understanding within the Director General portfolio and Director General himself and his fellow, the directors within that area, of how what we are taking forward and how we are working to drive that improvement that we all seek. But it doesn't get away at all of our direct role with ministers.
So the last question, can be for me. Just on that basis, I'm sorry to be, pursue this, but in terms of performance outcomes, I mean, who does the measurement of Education Scotland? I mean, how do you determine, or who determines you're delivering against your ambition as explained in the 2012 framework document? How and who knows which improvements in Scottish education are a result of the work of Education Scotland or of other factors? Where, who's quotes on the nail?
Yeah, well, certainly mine, but as accountable officer for the agency. But I can maybe ask you to say a word in a minute about how we've developed stronger ways of trying to get external evaluation and feedback on the performance of the agency and how effective we are being in driving improvement in the system. Of course, we work through other people. We don't, at our first hand, deliver education directly, but we work through local authorities and a range of other people. So fundamentally, the agency is all about supporting improvement and influencing. So that does present challenges in getting a full account of exactly how effective our work is being. But we have done quite a bit of work on that. Alastair, do you want to?
Yes, I mean, the first thing to say would be that it is very difficult to disentangle what any single contributor, their role is in actually achieving improvement, because there's lots of players within the education field. But that's exactly what we're trying to do through something called contribution analysis, trying to understand what our contribution is as a national agency alongside the other players, including local authorities, schools, whatever the areas are. So in terms of the work we've been doing over the past 2 years, we've been looking at creating a set of clear outcomes for us as an agency and then defining how we will gather evidence against those outcomes to prove that we are actually making the impact that we want to do, and then amending our programmes of work in light of that. Now, that is still work at early stages. It's a very challenging process to do. We can easily tell whether our work is well received because we systematically gather that kind of information. But there's a different question there about whether it actually makes an impact and makes a difference on the education system.
Sorry, can I ask? I wonder if you would kindly give me a couple of examples. Let's see, your paper says you work with a whole range of bodies. How does that contribution analysis work in relation to independent schools, firstly, and the likes of SDS? How does that impact your outcome analysis?
Well, the first thing is, obviously, we have to work in partnership with an independent school sector, SCIS, the organisation that's an umbrella organisation for independent schools. But we do obviously work more directly with independent schools because there's fewer other players in that area. So we would have a set of objectives in relation to independent schools, set of outcomes that we're trying to achieve. In relation to that, we would gather direct evidence. An example would be, and we are doing far more work in terms of following up after inspection after a period of time. So, for example, after 6 months or a year, going back and actually asking what contribution did inspection play in the improvements that have taken place in a particular school or service. And that's something that we're increasingly doing. We're applying that same process to things like the events that we hold, the resources that we produce, because although they may be well received, what we want to do is make sure that they're actually making a difference on the front line. So in independent schools, that's more direct. Our work with SDS through, for example, careers information and guidance, then obviously we would sit down collectively together and where possible agree what we're trying to do and what our respective roles are. And that helps us to do that contribution analysis. What is it that we are putting into the system alongside the other key players that are putting it in as well? So we'd have some overarching outcomes that we're trying to achieve. But obviously within that, what is it that we are particularly trying to do that's our contribution towards that?
Okay, thank you.
Okay. Just to follow up on that, Mr. Delaney, you just said you would sit down and agree with SDS where possible, which sounded like a caveat of some sort. I mean, where is it not possible? Where are the problems? Is there a clash? Is there a gap? Is there an overlap? Why did you say where possible?
No, I just meant that different organisations will have different objectives overall. So we have collective areas of interest, and we will have specialist areas of interest. That was simply the caveat. That obviously SDS has a particular role and remit and responsibility, and so do we. So there are areas of overlap, and that's where we would sit down and agree what our collective contribution is, and therefore our individual contribution to that.
Okay, I just wanted to clarify that's what it was rather than something more interesting. Can I take you, you've begun to talk about your breadth of activity a little bit, so let's move into that area. You do a whole range of things as Education Scotland, and I would suggest that over the recent times it's been increasing the range of activities that the organisation has. However, the EIS, for example, expressed concern. They stated, and I just quote from them, the support function which Education Scotland inherited from LTS, that's learning, LTS has been marginalised in significant ways. Would you agree with them or disagree with them?
I wouldn't. I was surprised to see that comment. We've put a huge amount of effort, for example, into the curriculum development work, which would traditionally have been LTS work, I guess. And indeed, that's been a major priority for us in recent times. So I'm not sure exactly where that comment's coming from. Certainly, we continue to focus on both the evaluation and the support side, but support's been very prominent lately, particularly in the school sector.
So you don't agree with EIS comment about the transition between Learning Teaching Scotland and yourselves?
No, I don't believe we've lost anything of the capacity that was available.
Why do you think they said that?
And I know it later in their submission they do have positive things to say about some of the specifics around that, where we have worked together, for example, to tackle the bureaucracy agenda in primary schools. Why they say that, I'm not sure whether they simply hark back to a day when they could engage with two separate organisations. Perhaps that felt more substantial to them than engaging with one, but we do work closely with the EIS, and indeed some of our more, we've had some good successful events, I think, recently where ourselves, we have fielded staff with the EIS to work on some of the national priority issues around CFE to good effect.
Is it perhaps because there's been certainly there's a risk, there's a danger, perhaps even an accusation, that the organisation, Education Scotland, I mean, has been spread too thin, given the breadth of activity we've discussed.
Like all organisations, we are certainly having to focus hard to, as we are working with a reduced core budget overall. But I think the benefits of being able to engage right across from early years through to lifelong learning are very great and well worth preserving. Hence, I think the focus we have to ability to range across those areas is requires us to be very careful about where we place our resources, and it means that we can't just continue, and perhaps this is some of the nostalgic stuff from LTS would be, we can't just continue churning out resources in areas that aren't a priority area, which we might once have done when resources were more available. But I think it is really important that we have that broad spectrum of view of the education system, 0 to 19 and beyond into adult learning.
Okay, because ADES, and you'll have noted this in their evidence, I'm sure, said that while the inspection programme reaches out across all areas of the country, that is not the case with the developmental activity.
Again, and I would simply disagree with them on that, and I think we've got, there's a range of examples we could field around work we're doing as far north as Shetland and indeed Orkney, if Liam might have come across. But we spread across. I think they may be confusing the fact that our staff are predominantly based in the Central Belt, but nonetheless we maintain offices around Scotland, in Inverness, Aberdeen and elsewhere, and actually all our staff range across Scotland. They don't necessarily work where they're based by any means. So we do have a range of, we could happily elaborate on if you wish, of specific examples in Aberdeenshire and Shetland and other areas where specifically support activity is going on strongly.
So you don't have any concerns that have been expressed in some of the comments to us about the that there may be areas of the country where, let's put it in a positive way, your support and development could be further enhanced?
It's very bespoke. I mean, there's always areas which we will spend, flex our resources to spend a little more time in some authorities than others to address priorities with them. We're doing a lot of work in the borders, for example, to move to the other end of the country too at the moment, very successfully working with the new head of education there to address issues across borders schools. We will bespoke and customise our offer, our support offer, in every local authority area, and we do that through our partnership agreements with local authorities, which are negotiated annually.
Is it your view that the organisation has expanded in a logical, sensible and strategic fashion, or has it been a bit more ad hoc? I mean, is that an unfair criticism that the expansion has been slightly ad hoc?
I think it's unfair. We have had a lot of work to do from the merger to create the ability to manage our resources more strategically, having inherited resources from several sources, but having done that, I think over the last 2 or 3 years in particular, we've developed the ability to be much more strategic in the way we focus and move around resources. Probably the most recent example of that is the way we've been able to reprioritise and focus, bend our resources to pick up the work on the attainment challenge and the national improvement framework in a very rapid fashion.
Just a final question from me, if you don't mind. You talk about synergies, efficiencies, having a broad overview of the whole system. Can you give us some concrete examples of those synergies and those efficiencies and how they have directly benefited learners?
Yes, I certainly can. I think they occur at three levels, and maybe Alistair's got to pick up some of the concrete examples. But for me, it can happen both at the level of the individual establishment or service, where we can combine both an evaluation and follow that through with specific support for that service or school or college or wherever to help them and drive their improvement. And we've got examples of that. We certainly also have at local authority level, where we've engaged clearly with a local authority that has local issues that where we have helped identify and evaluate those issues, but then moved in to help support. And thirdly, it can happen at national level, where we pick up produce a national thematic report, such as we did recently in technologies, and move in a programme of support in the aftermath of what we've found, what we've been able to identify as the key issues in that particular area of the curriculum. But you know, if you want to illustrate more.
Thank you. Yes, one of the key areas where I think we've managed to balance resources between ourselves and local authorities are through the local partnership agreements, because what that allows us to do is to come to an agreement at each local authority level about what the strengths of that local authority area are and what areas of improvement are, and then make bespoke contributions to that, because it may well be that the local authority itself or a neighbouring local authority has a strength in that area and so can make a development itself. It may well be they're looking for support from us, or that we can broker from another agency. And so in that way, we make sure that what we don't do is apply the same model of approach, or what is it, whatever it is that we want to develop across all 32. It's actually bespoke to each of the local authority areas and the schools and colleges and services, etc., which are within that area. So it's a good example of where we are maximising what is limited resources available to all of us to improve the quality in a local area.
Thank you. Gordon MacDonald.
Thank you very much, Convener. I was wanting to move on to the subject of your expenditure over the last few years. And I noticed in 2014-15 that you had a budget overspend of £3.7 million. How does that compare to previous year's outturns?
Yeah, and to some extent that reported overspend is a presentational technical issue, because it was a predictable, it's primarily down to a predicted amount of resource that was required for GLO and the development of GLO at that time. In previous years, a transfer of money came in, so it didn't show within the accounts in the same way, but fundamentally the same process happened. I mean, just to explain where that comes from, effectively...
But just to be clear, in previous years you reported an underspend for the three previous years, is that right?
Yes, that's right, indeed. The first 2 years, in fact, of course, we were dealing with quite a complex accounting scenario where the merger of all the previous organisations, and one of which was an NDPB for us, and another was in the civil service, was still being rationalised to a large extent. And indeed, we were going through significant reductions of staffing. Mm-hmm. But that was the scenario.
I could just contribute one further thing. It is complicated because, as an executive agency, our budget is part of the ELL portfolio. Mm-hmm. And so the budget is actually managed at that level, but mm-hmm. we have to report our own accounts because mm-hmm. of being an executive agency, which makes it more complicated. But to give you figures, we've made efficiency savings of 6%, 6%, 8%, then 3% over the past four mm. years. But that's a contribution to the overall portfolio. Mm. And so it's less an underspend, if you see what I mean, rather than our contribution to efficiency savings that were required to take place. And that took us through from 11-12 to 14-15, those figures.
Right. And between your final outturn of 2013-14 and your final budget of 2014-15, you had an increase of 5%, yet you still managed to produce an overspend that year despite getting a 5% increase in your budget. So, you know, what was the reasons for those overspends?
I have to separate out again. We have a core budget, and then mm-hmm. we have predicated funding that comes in during the mm-hmm. year. So our core budget over the years, if you take the core, and they're not directly comparable because of the four agencies coming together, but at 2010-11, just prior to the merger, we had 40.3 of a million of a core budget. Mm-hmm. And last year, that was 21.8 of a core budget. That's a reduction from the year before of 23.3 of the mm-hmm. core. But what happened was that during the year, we were asked to take on further activity, and on some of the occasions, we were given additional in-year funding for that. Mm-hmm. So the in-year funding has gone up. So in that period you're talking about, it went up from 11.7 to 13.6 million. Mm-hmm. But those are predicated funding, and actually quite a large chunk of that is grant money, of which it comes to us, and then we issue it to other agencies as well. So it's not even money that we have any control over.
But what I'm trying to get is, in our briefing paper, there was an explanation for your overspend as relating to ICT and learning, Scottish Improvement Partnership, School Improvement Partnership programmes, VAT liability, and also GLO. So what was the main reason for these overspends?
Well, again, they're not overspends in as much as at the very beginning of the year they were scored as pressures on the portfolio.
Yeah.
So we knew right from the start that the money wasn't there to actually mm-hmm. deliver on these programmes. And that's a standard practice across the whole of the portfolio, mm-hmm. given that efficiencies occur during the year. Mm-hmm. So those figures are correct. Those were the four areas that we had, including the provision for VAT liability, which is an mm-hmm. ongoing dispute with HMRC. But we made
what's the basis of that dispute? How did that arise?
Yeah, well, it's because HMRC took a view that if we use secondees, we were liable to VAT. And in previous times, they had not said that that was the case. And so ourselves and local authorities have taken that case up with HMRC, and we are mm-hmm. still pursuing that, and we still don't have a final resolution. Mm-hmm. So we have to make a provision just in case mm-hmm. it comes to the fact that
and
HMRC...
And what's the value of that provision?
£1 million.
Right, okay.
So adding that up, that was 4.5 million. We could have taken a transfer mid-year when the portfolio knew it was able to cover that, but we didn't, because what we didn't want to do was take money from other areas of the portfolio when we felt we still had efficiencies that we could make ourselves. Mm-hmm. And we managed to achieve 700,000 of additional efficiencies during that period mm-hmm. till the end of the year, which took it down to 3.8. But the problem was that because of our accounting processes, then it shows as if we were overspent in our accounts, whereas that's yeah. across the portfolio, it was covered and managed at the time.
Yeah. I'm just trying to understand, you know, how they came about. I understand the VAT situation sure. to provide for £1 million because of the potential change in ruling. Mm. But in terms of, say, ICT and learning, when you look at the figures, you had an in-year transfer for ICT learning of £5 million. But looking at your accounts, it says you had a ICT infrastructure cost of £3.6 million. So that would suggest that you had an in-year transfer higher than what you actually spent in ICT. Yet you're saying part of the reason for your overspend is because of ICT.
Again, it's complicated. The ICT and Learning Programme is a joint programme between ourselves and Learning Directorate and Government. And so it's managed and it's across those boundaries as a single programme. Mm-hmm. At the beginning of the period of that programme, it was understood, that, and it involves GLOW, for example, that there was a requirement to actually redo GLOW, to update it, and that the programme overall, therefore, knew that it needed to run higher than the original programme spend at the spending review in 11 and mm-hmm. set aside. That programme, jointly across ourselves, was managed within that budget, and it stayed within that budget. It's just about which account codes were used to pay for what that the transfers are done, because at the moment the programme is being transferred to us in its entirety from the 1st of April. Mm-hmm. So there was a period of transfer where we were paying more from our accounts than mm-hmm. Was being paid for from Learning Directorate account codes. It's just a technicality again as to how these things are dealt with. So our overall liability was 2.8 million in that area that we knew was over and above what the programme had initially set out to achieve, but that was what was agreed between ourselves and Learning Directorate and Government as the total programme cost for that programme as a joint programme.
And in terms of GLOW, in the two previous years, again comparing your development cost for GLOW and what you got in your transfers that was related to GLOW, you substantially underspent on those two previous years on GLOW to the tune of about £4.3 million. Now, you say that you operate, according to the submission to the committee, you operate a zero-based budgeting approach. So why was there nothing allocated in GLOW in 2014-15? And you spent £4 million, so that was that £4 million the previous year's cumulative underspend brought forward, or why was it not budgeted for in 2014-15?
I'm not sure I quite understand the...
I think there's a part of the confusion with that is that some of the resource that's transferred in for us to do GLOW is to meet contribution of our core staffing and various resources that we have, which would not be perhaps particularly visible in our accounts as going out again, because some of the resource we take in we use to pay contractors for work which goes out, and that's the bit that would be clearly transparent.
So the end-year transfer includes staff costs.
Indeed.
And on the accounts you yep. absorb that into the heading for staff costs.
Yes, absolutely.
Right. So that only leaves the other point. Yep. If you operate zero-based budgeting and you spent £4 million on GLOW in 2014-15, why was there no budget for GLOW in 2014-15?
No, that's not. We operate zero-based budgeting for all of our programmes apart from the Digital Learning and Teaching programme, because it's a joint programme with Learning Directorate. Our contribution was established from the beginning. And so that money was set aside. So we had a set aside amount of money for our contribution to that programme. Our zero-based budgeting approach for all our other pieces of work just means that every year what we do is that we make sure that we don't have just a historical spend. We actually review what is required at that point in time for that coming year. The digital orientation programme was a longer-term programme where we had a commitment over a period of years.
Right. And could you just say a wee bit more about what the School Improvement Partnership programme is?
It's a programme that we do together with Glasgow University, which is based on collaborative work between schools. So what it tries to do is to promote collaboration between and within schools across boundaries. So that could be across sectoral boundaries or geographic boundaries. And it was based on international research, which the Glasgow University worked with us to actually look at how we could implement that in Scotland. We were trying it out as a programme to understand mm-hmm. how that would work in Scotland. Mm-hmm. We're a small country, but there are still quite a few boundaries mm-hmm. that get in the way of people collaborating. And so we've written up an interim report and now a final report that was launched at the Scottish Learning Festival to understand how we would promote this work going forward. It should be embedded, to be honest, as part of the way we do business in Scotland, but this was a pilot project to understand what was required.
Okay, thanks so much.
Can I ask a couple of quick questions about the budgeting? Your budget for grant payments to external organisations increased from 1.8 million in 11-12 to 5.9 million in 14-15. Quite a substantial, quite a steep increase over those short number of years. Can you provide us some background and the reasons for that?
Yeah, that's the direct consequence of a transfer of responsibilities from core policy directorates in Scottish Government for grants around about youth and adult learning territory, where we agreed it made more sense for the agency now to manage directly the relationship with a range of organisations who receive grants. It includes Youth Link, for example.
Yeah. All the strategic funding partnerships, which were administered through ourselves, used to be administered by government themselves, they're administered through ourselves.
No, that's fine.
It's a rationalisation.
Yep. Yeah. Okay. And secondly, just in terms of the end-year transfers, the respecting rights, nothing in 12-13, nothing in 13-14, 1.6 million in 14-15. Again, is that, what's that?
Yep. I need to get back to you with exactly what that's for. It's the same process, I'm sure. We've been looking at a whole range of areas with policy directorates in Scottish Government as to where it makes more sense for particular relationships and grant programmes to lie. We talked about the youth one earlier, but that was an example of that that sits in that territory.
Thank you, Ben. It's probably the inclusion for all grants. I think that's what that actually is, although I would have to go back and double check.
Well, it's nothing to do with the rights respecting school stuff, is it?
No, I don't think that would be to that order.
No.
We're involved in promoting that work directly ourselves, but it wouldn't have that kind of funding attached to it, and I'm sure you're right, it is in fact it's the access.
Well, if you could write to us afterwards with the detail of that, I would be grateful. Mark?
Thanks, you mentioned about the flexibility and responsiveness of the organisation, and just to ask what's been the financial impact of that flexibility, particularly around the attainment challenge. What's been the financial impact on your core work as a result of you responding to that?
Yep. We're still in the process really of working through exactly where we put resources in terms of the attainment challenge, but we are certainly one of the big commitments we took on, for example, was to ensure that there will be an attainment advisor available for every local authority in Scotland, and we now have 30 of the 32 in place, and we should have the other two in place by the end of November on schedule. And that has an impact, as you identified, particularly as a number of those individuals will be recruited from outside, but some will also be our own staff who we will, where we have capacity, we will refocus that capacity on them playing a part-time role for some of the smaller local authorities, for example. So partly it is about refocusing our own resources through using our business planning system to see where we can stop doing something or downsize a piece of activity to free up time from staff. And in other cases, it's around freeing up resource in order to bring in secondees for a programme. And we always run a healthy number of secondees, it has to be said, I think around 60-ish secondees to support specific programmes of work. That gives us a lot of flexibility because it means secondees can come on stream but also off stream as priorities shift and change.
And have you identified any of those areas where you said you'd be downscaling the work to support the attainment fund?
Yeah, well, I mean, one of the strategic shifts we're currently making, and without wishing to suggest that Curriculum for Excellence is all over and it's all in place, fully needing no support, we are actually, we had a huge hump in terms of the provision of support for CFE, new qualifications around about NQ5, 4, et cetera, and then higher over the last couple of years. As that's moved on, we're still have a more targeted programme of support there, but we've been able to release some resource from that territory to refocus on the attainment challenge, which in any event to me is really the next step in extracting the full benefits of the new curriculum, is beginning to drive out improvement for the young people from more disadvantaged backgrounds.
Okay. Other question I had was just on the impact on your organisation of having such a large percentage of your budget made up of in-year transfers. How does that affect your strategic planning, your financial planning? Normally, organisations would expect to plan going forward on the basis of spending review periods. How's such a big in-year transfer affected that ability?
Yeah, it does make it more complex because it kind of reduces our degrees of freedom to some degree. We have much more control over our core spending. With the in-year transfers means, certainly it means that we have to be ready to shift during a year. In fact, the School Improvement Partnership Programme Alastair was talking about earlier was an example of that, where we took on a pressure as a ministerial announcement and decision mid-year, effectively, to set up this new programme of School Improvement Partnership work. And we agreed to take that on as a pressure and try and absorb it during the year as far as possible, but the portfolio ultimately had was able to absorb it if not. So we can adapt to reasonable size adjustments in that way in year. Beyond that, we need to look at year-on-year adjustment to our spend in order to accommodate larger new adjustments, and that's where so we would tend to focus those in a year. So, for example, taking over the grants for youth, as you say, is quite a big chunk, 5 million or whatever of grants we're now giving out. Then we would time that for the following year and get the judgment, getting our budget adjusted to suit from the following year.
But as part of our budget scrutiny going forward, that ideally you would prefer to see fewer in-year transfers and the budget to be set out clearly in advance?
I think it's very helpful. The more it can be set out in the advance, I'm realistic enough to know that politics isn't going to be perfectly adjusted to suiting our budget cycle, so we do need to be ready to adjust and respond when a new initiative comes along that would benefit from our input. And the last thing I want to be doing is saying that, sorry, we can't help with that until next year if it's going to be far too late to make a significant impact in that kind of area of work. But ideally, the more long-term advance warning we have of issues coming up and needing significant resource from us, the better.
I meant to ask you a final question on the grants thing. The increase we've seen over the last few years, up to 5.9 million in 14-15, is that the end of it? Is that plateauing now, or is it going to carry on increasing? You're shaking your head, Mr. Delaney.
Yeah, negotiations ongoing that could possibly see further transfers or such responsibilities to us as an agency that would see that figure increasing. Yeah.
Nothing on that scale, I don't think. Well, you'll have better.
it could take it up to about 9 million.
So it is
a substantial chunk of money that we're currently negotiating.
From 1 point something up to 9 point something.
Yeah, over quite a short period of time.
Mm-hmm. Okay. When's that likely to happen?
From the 1st of April next year.
Soon.
Fundamentally, it's not particularly problematic for us, if it makes sense. It's money we can manage through. We have set up a grant managing team within the organisation.
If you're going from process. 1 point, well, with all due respect, I accept that if you're distributing a pound and then you're distributing £10, it's the same process that's involved.
Yeah.
But if it's going from the kind of figures we've been talking about, just over 1 to 9 something in terms of millions, that surely requires perhaps more staff, greater time,
yes,
more input, more accounting, yeah, checking, etc. No, that must be a cost on the organisation.
There is a cost to the organisation. We've reallocated some staff to create a centralised grants team, and that ensures consistency across these grant schemes, which is a good thing. So, I mean, that is a benefit. That actually means that we're approaching all of these different schemes that sometimes similar agencies are applying for in a very consistent way. But it does put pressure on the people who are deciding on the grants, I think, our educational staff as well, because then there's far more volume for them to do. But some of these grants are large. I mean, some are over £1 million on their own in a single grant. So, again, it can be that some are very small. To be honest, the bigger ones are easier than taking on responsibility for much smaller ones, because obviously the volume of each individual case is much higher.
Okay. And government, to be fair, recognise that there is an on-cost that comes with us taking on these grants to increase the administrative capacity to deal with them. So.
No, thank you for that. Colin Beattie.
Thank you, Convener. I'd like to look at aspects around the autonomy of Education Scotland. Now, Education Scotland is an executive agency, it's staffed by civil servants and it's accountable to ministers. The submission from EIS expresses some concern about, and I quote, the increasingly politicised role of Education Scotland. And again, questions remain about the independence of the inspection process and its relationship to government policy. How would you respond to that?
I'm surprised to see that. I don't think fundamentally our constitutional position vis-a-vis Education Scotland in comparison to HM Inspectorate of Education, for example, before the merger is exactly the same. From my point of view, the degree to which we are involved in closely working with government is a good thing, because it helps us inform government policy, provide a good source of evidence into that. But there are very clear firewalls which preserve our independence. And I think the familiar mantra that we need to be able to report without fear or favour is very well written into our constitution, if you like, through our framework document in particular. It's partly why we have a specific role accountable to the chief executive as director of inspection. So we have a senior member of staff as director of inspection who preserves the integrity of the inspection process and various processes around that, which Alastair, as he is director of inspection, could explain a little more if you wish around how that works. And I also see it very clearly understood by ministers, actually, that the last thing they need really is an agency that just tells them what they want to know, rather than an agency that really can generate good independent evidence and provide that to them through a variety of briefing sources. So personally, I feel it's very clear how we report and evaluate independently. We've had, in practical, realistic terms, I think, I can't actually remember a specific challenge where an inspection or a piece of evaluative work we've undertaken has been challenged on the grounds that we were somehow, our independence had been lost in the process. So,
given the perception from EIS, are there any ways that you can avoid such accusations in the future by putting in place different processes, different firewalls? Is there ways to improve that distancing?
We're always keen, and I'm very conscious that not only being independent is important, but everybody recognising and understanding that is the case is also important. So certainly we'll continue to engage with the EIS and others. We do have regular meetings with the EIS, actually, direct one-to-one meetings to take their views directly.
Have they raised this with you before?
Not strongly of late, I have to say, but of course it's always been, and I think it always was prior to Education Scotland with the inspectorate, an area of discussion, because there will be times when the EIS are promoting a particular view of the world. That would happen within any context, whereas ours might be different and it might be more aligned with government or it might not, but that's something we work with.
Perhaps another facet of this. The Royal Society of Edinburgh queried the rationale of you carrying out both inspection and curriculum development And I quote, there are inherent risks in a body that has both policy development and quality assurance responsibilities. How would you respond to that?
Again, we have our very clear firewalls in place, and that's part of our response to that. But fundamentally, I think we have great synergies and advantages from having an association between an ability to feed through our evaluation into our curriculum development work, but I don't think in any way it undermines the integrity of the curriculum development work.
How do you balance this, though? I mean, you're supporting the needs of the schools and teachers,
yep.
And you have responsibilities also for delivering Scottish Government priorities. How do you balance that, and who's your main customer?
Well, fundamentally and ultimately, our main customer is the learner, and we work through supporting various agencies. Certainly, as National Improvement Agency, we have a key role in supporting the effective implementation of government policy, and that's natural and core to our activity. But we also, taking the intelligence that we gain from our constant engagement with the system, look to surface concerns or issues that come from that we're seeing out in the system from schools or wherever, and respond to those to help support. The bureaucracy example in primary schools would be an example of that, where we've worked, and I know the EIS note, we've worked well with them to tackle issues which have arisen through the implementation of CFE that effectively were coming from the ground up through schools' experience. And we customise our work with local authorities, as we've described earlier.
You mentioned previously that you thought there was an advantage in yourself engaging closely with ministers and the Scottish Government in terms of being able to influence policy and so forth. What involvement have you had with ministers in developing the current attainment agenda?
We have had close engagement from the start around the development of policy on the attainment challenge, working alongside colleagues, the policy directorate, clearly learning directorate, taking the lead in developing policy, but ourselves working very closely in that. As a result of that, we've now, as it's moving towards a phase of implementation and beginning to develop the attainment challenge out in practice, we have an increasing role, I think, and have appointed shifted one of my senior management team into playing a lead role, a professional leadership role for the education sector, and taking forward the attainment challenge and working it through into practical action out in schools.
Just ask you one other question which derives from your submission.
Yep.
In fact, page 10, 4.1, final paragraph, you state, whilst it's unlikely that any particular intervention by Education Scotland would be the sole reason for improvement happening in any establishment, etc. Seems a bit negative to me. I mean, I realise you can't be the sole intervention that would result in something good happening, but surely you must be a major contributor. You should be a major contributor.
Yes, indeed. Maybe it's an excess of humility, but we certainly do actually seek to maximise our input. But I think that's also recognising that fundamentally it is frontline practitioners who deliver change for learners, and we only work through influencing what they do fundamentally in a whole variety of ways we seek to do that. But fundamentally, it ends in the classroom or the community centre or wherever learning is taking place. And that's the more we recognise and work in partnership with providers, the better. And, of course, with local authorities who have a statutory duty to be improving education in their areas. So we work through influence, and we will continue to recognise that, I guess.
Perhaps I can slip one more in. Page 12, you make a statement, complaints about inspection are low. Is that good?
Yeah, it's a good question, actually, because I guess zero complaints would be worrying at one level. You might wonder if that simply meant that nobody ever bothered complaining or were frightened to complain, but I don't think that is the case. We do respond. In fact, all our complaints the last wee while are generally resolved at the very earliest stages. We have the earliest stage in our complaints procedure is an informal discussion with the person who has an issue to see if we can work our way through it.
What sort of percentage of your inspections result in a complaint? And what's the definition of a complaint?
A complaint, we take a broad definition in terms of the numbers that we record. So really anyone who's raised a matter that's of concern to them during inspection, sometimes actually it's not about the inspectors, or it could be about other aspects, the timing of it, or indeed the local authority support for the school has been raised as a complaint. But we have, I think, in terms of percentage terms, we have numbers of...
It's under 10% result in any kind of complaint, but complaint, its most obvious sense is where there's still an ongoing discussion between ourselves and the establishment, say, about whether we've got it right. And we take, obviously, additional evidence, we talk to people about it, we try to come to a reasonable position. And so that we regarded and we recorded as a complaint under our complaints procedure.
So I think you work towards a compromise result?
No, not necessarily a compromise, because we've got to be very clear that we would only respond to further additional evidence that we may not have seen at the time. An inspection team going into a school at any point in time, or any other establishment, is there at a point in time. And we are, as an inspection team, the way we'd want to approach that is to be open, so that if we didn't see something or there was other evidence that we didn't pick up on, that this school or establishment would be able to highlight that to us afterwards. And we would then negotiate and discuss that. But ultimately, it's not coming to the lowest common denominator. It's not coming to just an agreement. It's actually saying there needs to be evidence that we perhaps haven't picked up on during the week. The vast majority of what we would class as complaints are at that level. I mean, you need to separate that from complaints of nature such as conduct of inspectors or complaints after the report is published, about the whole process, which are negligible.
We also, I should say, have a process which I'm pleased with. The professional associations, the EIS in particular, cooperate with us on this, but they share privately any feedback they're getting, which is another independent source, because, of course, every school we inspect has an EIS rep or whatever in the school. And they themselves ask their reps to feedback on their experience of inspection, and they share that with us confidentially on a regular basis, and that's an encouraging picture. It's a generally good picture overall.
Okay, thank you, Colin. Can I just pick up some of the questioning that Colin was just asking, and questions from Mark earlier. Clearly, you were just been discussing the issue about this tension between being responsible for delivering Scottish Government priorities and also dealing with, for example, the support needs of teachers and schools and learners, the ability to criticise as well as support government policy. So on the one hand, you've got that tension, and you've also got a situation where your budget, as was discussed with Mark, where up to a third of it is in your transfers. I'm just wondering what the influence of is waiting on whether or not to see whether you get a third of your budget during an in-year transfer affects the ability to operate proactively as an organisation, or are you sitting back waiting effectively to react to whether or not there'll be in-year transfers, and how that structure impacts on the ability to that balance you have to strike between these different sides of the organisation's activities?
I should start by saying that although in-year transfers do constrain funding, because they mean the funding you get is ring-fenced for that purpose, and sometimes they come mid-year, but more often they come as a result of a planned discussion, development of a policy, which we've been involved in from quite an early stage, and indeed may have influence from an early stage, so they may well not. An in-year transfer can be a perfectly good thing that suits everyone's strategic view of the next priorities. Indeed, there, as may well be the case with attainment challenge, for example, if there's resource required to support our work in relation to the attainment challenge, and as we're very comfortable with that, we've been part of the process of discussing the attainment challenge right from the start, and it's an area where we'd want to be refocusing resource as best we can, as well as refocusing some of our core funding to support the work in that area. So they don't necessarily, I suppose what I'm trying to say is they don't necessarily all come out the blue and get in the way or tie our hands down in ways we wouldn't agree with. I think often they are on important priorities. We've had a large chunk of work, for example, on health and well-being over recent years, which I think has been, and that's all ring-fenced in your transfer money, which we use, but it's helped us do a great deal of very positive work in health and well-being on the PE, 2 hours PE in schools agenda, and generally promoting physical activity, healthy diet, etc., in schools. So it can be managed well.
That's helpful, but I suppose I'm asking fundamentally about the ability of an organisation like your own to act independently and be critical and proactive in its operations while holding its breath and waiting to see whether up to a third of its budget is going to arrive as a in-year transfer.
The core, the bulk of our budget still will be, and I think I don't see any great threat to that, will continue to be a core budget which is unconstrained of that sort. I'm certainly not feeling any pressure to be uncritical of government in that sense, although fundamentally that point is often raised to, you know, is it our role to be critical of government policy? Well, I don't see it as the role of the agency, to be honest, as being some completely left field organisation that lobbies government on behalf. We're much more involved with informing government policy, but fundamentally it's for government ministers to make policy decisions. It is then our role, I think, to help give government feedback on the impact, whether those policies are achieving the desired impact effectively or not. And if they're not, it's really important we're feeding that back so that adjustments could be made to policy to address that. But fundamentally,
that's what I was trying to get to, effectively. Yeah. You know, the ability to feel that you are completely free in that kind of constructive criticism that should drive government policy or changes in government policy.
Yeah. Actually, you know, if we're not doing that, then we're really reducing our potential value to ministers and to everybody. Yeah.
Mary Scanlon.
Thank you. I would just like to move on to questions about accountability and quality assurance. Representing the Highlands, as I've done since 1999, I've actually met a lot of teachers, a lot of head teachers, particularly in small villages throughout the Highlands, who have never worked again following your inspection. In fact, when I look at your principles, mutual respect, building on self-evaluation, partnership working, and your comment to Colin Beattie about your excess of humility, I have to say these teachers did not find that. I thought, convener, it was perhaps just a Highland issue, but Terry Shevlin, the clerk, and I had an informal meeting, as all members of this committee did, with directors of education and finance directors in local government. Not every local authority was there, but a significant number were. And at the end of the meeting, we just threw in a question about, well, what's your views of Education Scotland? And basically, there was a huge groan of disapproval, eyes rolling round her head. I'm not quite sure how that will be written up in the report. But no one had a good word to say about you. Now, I've mentioned your principles, what I've been told, and I met another two head teachers who have never worked since your inspection just last week. They talk about fear, trepidation, stress, traumatic, bullying, humiliation, no respect, dignity or value, or even just a little bit of kindness. Now, some of the papers we've got today mention Neil McKinnon serves the function of compliance and control. The EIS suggests the abandonment of formal inspection in favour of a model designed to provide support to teachers and educational establishments. So, I mean, I would have thought in a modern Scotland that you would be looking at valuing teachers, respecting teachers, working with them. That's not been my experience. And really, I've been really quite upset listening to some of these people that have never worked since you guys came in the door, and they are humiliated in their own communities. What do you say about your approach? I know that you said to Colin Beattie the complaints are low. What I'm told is they're terrified because they're picked on. And also, there is no right of appeal. So can I just ask you about your actual approach? Is there any need for that?
I'm certainly sorry to hear the experiences that you've
heard. I think you're very familiar with many of the cases I mentioned.
And there are one or two cases I would
more
be familiar with, but I would have to say they are a very small minority in which I suspect that the case. I mean, we do, if I can pick up, firstly, the point about people being frightened to respond, that's not our experience, and we do try hard to encourage every head teacher who's been inspected to give us a response. But equally, I'm sure they're not frightened to respond to the EIS, who also, as I said earlier, produce feedback, which they then feed to us. And they have said to us that it's a pretty good picture on the whole. It's, of course, there will sometimes be individuals who end up at the end of the process. And we believe in the best interest of the learner may sometimes not be in the right job, and that does happen. But that's not a common experience, and we certainly work very hard to make inspection and improvement focused and supportive activity. Indeed, one of the things we do with new inspectors as they join us is take them through a training programme in both effectively, it's a kind of social skills training programme and a programme in how you work as a consultant alongside individuals who you're evaluating in what is inevitably a quite pressured position during an inspection. But we have many testimonies I could equally share with you of schools who have found inspection a hugely empowering and positive experience. And indeed, I think it's 97% is the figure of head teachers who responding in a post-inspection questionnaire say that the inspection has helped them improve. We have worked very hard over many years actually to take, whereas there are other countries, other places in the world where inspection is quite deliberately set up as a confrontational, high-stakes accountability kind of regime, we've worked very hard not to have that. But that doesn't mean that occasionally when things are, when young people really are being underserved by poor provision, we may have to be quite strong in our evaluations. And indeed, in one case recently, we moved to almost immediate closure of an independent school, as the committee is probably aware, up north in Aberdeen. I don't make any apologies for doing that because I think it's ultimately important for the learners. But really, I would just reinforce my commitment is to make inspection as empowering a positive experience for good professionals as it can be.
Well, I have to put on the record, convener, that none of the head teachers in the schools I'm aware of were underperforming, and certainly no child was left behind as a result of a lack of that. So I'm not accepting that. Can I just say, given that you've quoted the EIS from our paper, convener, the EIS suggests the need for a strongly supportive approach. Possibly the abandonment of formal inspection in favour of a model designed to provide support for teachers and educational establishments. So I'm not accepting, they are suggesting something quite different, and no one goes into teaching to do a bad job, and I'm not absolutely picking up from people across the Highlands that this is supportive. So can I just move on to another point in Neil McKinnon's paper to this committee today. Inspection never delivers accountability. It only works if there's something to inspect against. And all at once, inspection is overwhelming and becomes a burden, second-guessing what they're looking for. And the RSE are asking how you gather evidence of schools and teachers' needs for support. That's what we're looking for. People can develop bad habits along the way, but we're looking for a supportive approach, not a humiliating, bullying, dictatorial approach. We're looking for something that values teachers. That doesn't seem to be coming through here.
I can only say that that absolutely is not our approach from my perspective. What we are clearly seeking to do is, fundamentally for us, inspection serves three purposes, and one of which is certainly about improving the capacity of schools at the frontline teachers or community workers or whoever we're inspecting to drive their own improvement and fundamentally empowering them to get help themselves get better. And that's an important purpose of inspection. But it does also serve the purpose of providing some assurance to parents, to the wider public, that the provision being made in a particular area is effective. And thirdly, it provides that source of evidence we were talking about earlier, which allows us to advise ministers on how progress is being made nationally or within particular regions of Scotland on key priority areas.
I think we can all agree with that. Rather than this heavy-handed approach, in a modern Scotland, I would have thought there should be a little bit of kindness, respect, dignity, a bit of value. Here's a bit of support. That's not what they're feeling. So my final point, should there be a right of appeal for head teachers? Because apparently there's nothing at the moment. And despite everything you say, Mr. Maxwell, according to the RSE, your staff employee survey says that only 28% of your staff feel that change is well managed. That's not much, about one in four. And only 30% were of the view that the changes that you're making in Education Scotland are for the better. So it doesn't even appear that your own staff are fully behind the changes. So your own staff, and should there be a right of appeal? And can you maybe look at just a little bit more dignity for teachers in future? I retire in 5 months, so that's my... I probably won't sit in front of you again, but I would like to ask that. I think everyone in every job deserves that.
I can reassure you exactly that absolutely dignity and empowering professionals is what I would want the organisation to be all about, and we'll work very hard to do that. In terms of a right of appeal, I think our processes are very clear. If we're thinking of a head teacher now being inspected, that we will feedback throughout an inspection the emerging messages that we're finding, the conclusions we're coming to, give some oral feedback before we leave the school, and then provide a draft report, a draft evaluation to the school, and give them an opportunity, as Alastair said earlier. It's not then a negotiation or compromise, but it's an opportunity for them to give us further evidence we may not have been aware of, or evidence that contradicts what appears to be the conclusions of the report. And we will then take account of that and form our professional view of whether that changes. Sometimes that shifts our evaluation, sometimes it may not. It depends on the nature of the evidence provided. And at that point, we provide our view to parents and the wider public. And that's...
What about your own staff not feeling your changes are well managed or for the better?
I know Alistair's got a fairly good lead summary of the staff survey results. We have certainly, it's certainly the case that through the merger, we have a fair bit of turbulence around staff feelings at the time, as the merger came quite rapidly and quickly, and we had a lot of change to make. To an organisation, all organisations coping, of course, with reductions and constraints in funding, but we far more than that when we were putting together a few organisations. But I was committed to having a regular staff survey throughout that time, so we have been through staff survey and sometimes more often through shorter focused exercises being clued into staff views. And I have to say, overall, the trend is positive in the direction of the results, including on leadership and managing change, which Alistair, you
mentioned. It's clearly not where we would want it to be, but yeah. I think that part of the issue is the fact that change is constant in the public sector and in our agency at the moment, and all of us would all like a little bit of opportunity, and most of my staff would, of having some breathing space from that change, but that is just not the kind of place that we're actually in. So because of that, yes, we have a lowest percentage at leadership management change, but it's 3% lower than the Scottish Government figure. And even the civil service UK-wide high performers are only at 50%, which is obviously 8% or so higher than us. It's obviously clearly an issue across the whole of the civil service that there's an awful lot of change going on and people are adapting and having to respond to that. I don't say that lightly. I still think that it's what we want to do, to do something about. We want our staff to really want to work for us as an organisation. organisation and to feel valued in their contribution to improving educational outcomes in Scotland. So it's something that we are very aware of, but I would say it's probably mainly down to the fact that there is so much change going on.
George Adam. Sorry, George, could you hold on 1 second? Can I just suspend briefly for a second?
A technical problem.
Yeah, I think so. Yeah, yeah.
No, the microphone's not working.
Yeah. Is one of the other ones working?
Really looking forward to it.
We're back.
Do you need to test it before we go?
No. We're all okay. Okay.
Do you need George from the very start?
Okay. Hang on. Whoa. Just. Everybody. Sorry, Mary. This is going to start again. Okay. Technical fault has been resolved.
That's fine.
Okay.
Hopefully I can ask the question without breaking the mic this time. But obviously, I asked earlier on about the Education Scotland's activity. You're mainly one of the main players in the bridging the attainment gap, but you don't deliver it yourself, and you're working with partner organisations to ensure that you deliver that. But when you're looking at the attainment challenge, ADES have said they had... ADES has concerns that the centrally driven model and that the current Raising Attainment initiative is following has been rapid development of ES staff without necessary engagement of all stakeholders, and they believe it's left some schools and local authorities feeling a lack of involvement. Why would ADES feel that way?
I think it's partly to do with this has been quite a rapid policy development, the attainment challenge, and a big important one, but it's not necessarily been pretty rapid. Of course, the Scottish Government policy directorates have working very closely with ministers and ourselves informing that, have had a lot of initial work to do just to get the basics agreed of how the programme would go forward. And I know there has been consultation through that process with ADIS particularly, although of course that doesn't necessarily percolate through to all 32 local authorities and the extent to which ADIS can genuinely feed back and take views from all its members is a matter for them really. But as we're moving forward now into a more operational process of delivering, designing the challenge, I think there is much greater involvement. It's particularly evident, for example, that I was quite recently at a meeting of all the local authorities and the 57 challenge schools who are enhancing the 57 challenge authorities. Those authorities, of course, have been quite heavily involved from the start. But yeah, the question, as it rolls out now, I think we're increasingly seeing a much greater engagement with a much wider, indeed, all 32 local authorities, because even beyond the challenge schools, we're now putting in place the attainment advisor for every local authority and working through with them how we can use that locally. And there's a lot of flexibility in how authorities can work with us to deliver this new model of working between us and them with a locally embedded attainment advisor supported as part of a national network by ourselves. So I think that will rapidly change.
I was quite interested in your comments earlier on with regards to the attainment advisors that 30 out of 32 are in place. That's happened quite quickly, which is quite good. But, you know, how do we see the role of the attainment advisors going forward, you know, with yourselves working with them? Obviously, they will be working for the local authority or within the local authority environment. So will they be the bridge between yourselves and the local authority? Will it be about getting resource into areas that need it? You know, currently we're using the SIMD figures for certain areas. Some people would say that's a blunt instrument to do it. But would the attainment advisors be the ones that would possibly, as times move on, actually see I need resource in that school or in that sector or that area?
Yes, exactly so. And brokering through ourselves where we can find that resource, either from our own central specialist teams, which we have, and we can deploy in targeted ways, working with local attainment advisors who identify need at a particular point in time. And also in networking across the 32 and sometimes in clusters. Actually, we're very keen on some of the work that's developing, I think, around clustering authorities in particular areas, the northern authorities, for example. And again, I think it's Highland and Aberdeen and others in the north, all seven plus Argyll and Bute, I think, now also interested in working as a collective to some extent, where we share the expertise of the attainment advisors. I'm very encouraged by that, and we're very keen to support that, because the collaboration and networking will be one of the key ways of
That's one of the things I'm quite interested in as well, because as Mary Scanlon said, we recently spoke to directors of education. It was an offline meeting from throughout the country. And the one I had, ironically, wasn't urban. It was more rural people that were there. I'm quite interested in the clustering of some of the up in the Highlands or Aberdeenshire kind of area, where they're all working together with the problem with teacher numbers make sure that they can work together to do that. So do you see more of that happening, or the clustering? Are you talking over 3-4 authorities or geographically over the authorities?
We do see more of that happening, and ADIS are very supportive of that approach. Indeed, they're driving it to a large extent. And I think it will certainly happen in regional clusters, however that may be, 7 or 8 across the country, but also sometimes thematically, where there's a few authorities interested in a particular issue, maybe it's Gaelic or 1+2 languages at a particular point in time, that we can also broker that kind of networking, which might cut across areas.
Okay, just one final question. One of the partnerships that you work with is the School Improvement Partnership Programme, and can you provide some examples of how this, you have kind of improved attainment from this programme in itself?
Yeah, I'll pass it over to Alastair, who actually set up and ran that programme initially, and be aware of the evaluation.
Yes, I mean, the evaluation report, which was published at SLF, gives full details, but I mean, a summation of what we found was that we had different kinds of partnerships, as I mentioned earlier. Some were joining up across sectors in a local area, so trying to make better linkages between the nursery provision, the primary provision, secondary provision, and another educational around about that. Some were across different parts of the country. We've had, I think it was Montrose, Perthshire, and an Edinburgh school working together, so three secondary schools working together. together with similar type challenges, but sharing staff and resources and ideas and training and things between each other. And the evaluation report found that these kinds of collaborations, different and bespoke and suitable to the individual circumstances, were really productive in sharing that expertise around the country, which is something that we as an agency would want to promote anyway, more generally. So if someone is doing something really well in a particular area, say a faculty or whatever in a secondary school, they were able to share that expertise with others. Not just what had happened potentially previously, where, say, after an inspection report, people would do a visit to a school to find out what they did. This is actual hands-on collaboration between different teachers from different schools, learning from each other, working together, and in some cases, sharing across the actual schools themselves. It was a small scale, you know, pilot project to see what would come out of it. But the results have been very, very positive in terms of their impact.
On that same point, just a final point, Convener, some of the colleges have been saying that because of the regionalisation of the colleges, they find themselves in a perfect place to be able to work with local authorities as well to try and get a regional educational kind of way of going forward. And I don't know if it's part of the design of the regionalisation, or it's happened by accident, or it's a few proactive principals that have gone down that route, but to me that seems to make an awful lot of sense, in being that how do we manage to make everything work for over a 3 or 4 local authority area, and I don't know what your opinion is on that.
Yeah, I think that's a very exciting potential from the new regional college model, working with clusters of local authorities as it will be around the senior phase, because for me that's one of the next challenges with CFE. Perhaps it's been very focused on schools until recently, but as senior phase develops, that needs to be looked at as provision in the round in an area. And indeed it's a challenge for us even in our evaluation work. We're piloting a senior phase review, i.e. looking at, I think it's in Murray, looking at all of the senior phase provision that the college and the local schools together make in the area, because I think driving that model of thinking of a network of provision in an area to meet young people's senior phase needs is the way ahead.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Mark Griffin.
I've got some questions on collaboration with partners, but just wanted to ask a quick question first on the inspection regime and the attainment gap, and just to ask whether going forward, as part of inspections, that the attainment gap, whether the attainment gap is maintaining, worsening or improving in a particular school, will that be reported on in the inspection regime going forward?
Yes, simple answer actually, yes. And the new toolkit, How Good Is Our School version 4, which we just launched at the Scottish Learning Festival, which is a revised, updated toolkit for self-evaluation, also used for inspection, that has clearly taken that very, very much on board. So you would see that traced there.
Okay, thanks. My question's on collaboration. Just ask what opportunities there are for greater joint working, joint planning with local authorities going forward.
Well, we're looking to continually develop the local partnership agreements, which we've established a couple of years ago and have grown, I think increasingly now grown in impact. And we've seen some particularly strong examples now where there's a very clear focus on driving a local improvement agenda. Scottish Borders does leap to mind as one of these examples, but also in Aberdeen, I was in recently, there's similarly talking to them about how that was focused in their case on areas like STEM. But Alastair, maybe I want to say a little bit of local partnership agreements, because...
Yeah, I think it's a really important development that we've made. We've only just put in place all 32. That was from about the 1st of April this year. So although the process started before that, we were moving to include everyone. So we did a rollout across the local authorities. And they are still a work in progress. They are not the finished article. But what we are trying to achieve from that is an agreement about the local needs in a local area, and then matching the local resources with the national resources to create one coherent plan about who's going to do what in the local area. That, as I said earlier, will help us reduce doing things in an area which nobody actually needs or wants, or could be done within the local resources that are available. And that means that we're targeting and prioritising what we do, but it means that it's bespoke then to each 32 local authorities, or in some cases, as a result of the attainment challenge, there are groupings coming together, and we're actually looking at creating one overarching plan as a result of that, where we pull our resources together. So it's definitely a direction of travel and something that we've been doing for the last couple of years.
Okay, thanks. The Royal Society of Edinburgh in particular had asked how Education Scotland gather evidence of schools and teachers' needs for support and how that support that you provide, how that's then evaluated.
Okay. We do it in a whole range of ways. We have so many engagements through inspection, but also through many of our other support and development activities with schools, that we do have a rich source of feedback to pick up on around current teachers' needs, and where we see those emerging on a consistent basis nationally, we can adapt and respond to that. It certainly was the case during the CFE implementation process, for example, and on occasion we deliberately did a wave of visits to schools where we would send, not inspections, but simply send some of our curriculum staff out to visit a range of schools. We did that with secondary schools, for example, around the new emerging senior phase curriculum models about a year ago.
Particularly with CFE and the new qualification, there was a criticism from the EIS about the support to teachers and pupils around the new curriculum related particular to exemplar papers. Do you have any response as to how you move forward, to how students will be provided with more support in that area so that they're better prepared for the new qualifications?
Yeah, well, we work very closely with the SQA, who I think you've also met recently. I mean, they produce exemplar papers, of course, so that's very much their part of the package. But we work closely with them also to provide events and resources around curriculum areas, particular subjects. We're particularly narrowing and focusing that in now, I think, on where we experience is suggesting the greatest need lies, and many of the subjects like STEM subjects, computing, maths, where we're particularly focusing on providing further opportunities, further resource and exchange of effective resources, because often the most effective support comes from seeing where other schools have managed, delivered courses really effectively and what resources they've developed for themselves. So we're working collaboratively, as I say, as part of a national partnership with SQA and IDES to get the best possible support in the system where it's most needed.
Okay, and finally, a question about collaboration and communication with Scottish Government. It's a very localised example, and I'll forgive you if you don't know the detail, but Education Scotland approved a merger of two Cumbernauld high schools on the proviso that the Scottish Government would part share the funding of a new building. That was only approved on the basis of the educational benefits. Just to ask what communication and collaboration you've got with the Scottish Government around the difficulties with the capital funding for a range of school builds across Scotland because of the decision by the EU on accounting methods.
You're right in that I don't have all that detail to hand. We don't deal directly with capital funding and school building programmes, very much an issue for Learning Directorate, policy colleagues. We don't take a direct role in that. Our role in looking at consultation and merger proposals like that is quite specific, and it was recently reset as a part of legislation, in fact, or adjustments to the statutory process, which... And we go in and look at the case as presented at the time, make an assessment of whether it's the process has been followed properly and educational benefits appear to be likely to accrue. And we leave that judgment with the authority. There are separate appeal mechanisms, as you'll be aware. We don't keep a long-term engagement with what might then unfold in terms of the further design of school buildings or whatever.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Quick supplementary from Mary Scanlon.
It is indeed very quick. Given what I mentioned before, and given as Mark Griffin was mentioning the attainment gap, we're now looking forward to assessments at various levels in primary, and I think it's S2 or 3. You could perhaps understand that many teachers, in particular head teachers, are quite scared of what's coming. Now, I'm not sure what high stakes or people have been worried that this is going to lead to leak tables and maybe further humiliation. Can you tell us how you see the once the new assessments come in, you know, will we have league tables of good and bad performing schools, or will it simply, as I hope it will be, looking at progress within each school? Because the last thing I would want, I fully support Scottish Government's assessment and attainment. My party fully supports that. But we certainly wouldn't want a system where schools that weren't performing as well were humiliated. Can you maybe just explain how the new system will work?
Yep, and of course it's out for consultation at the moment, so in a sense a lot of the detail of how the system will be designed is yet to be determined. But I think ministers have been very clear, as pleased to hear, that there is no intention to produce league tables on a national level or to drive a high-stakes comparison agenda such as you describe. Rather, it is all to be designed to support improvement at local level, individual schools and within local authorities, and to retain the primacy of teachers' more rounded judgments of attainment, being informed by data and informed by standardised assessments, but not being usurped or trumped by them. So fundamentally, I think
we want to see... So what information will be made public, convener? I just think it's an important one. Will it be the progress each school is making? Will it be the progress that they still have to make? What information will be made public that may allow these comparisons to be made?
It's still to be determined, so that decision hasn't been made, but I think it is an important point that it is really careful. We need to be very careful about how information is made public and how to protect against it being used crudely or inappropriately with counterproductive effects, if that were the case.
Yeah. The amendment hasn't yet been published that will come to the Education Scotland Bill. We will be taking evidence on it, obviously, Mary. And
I thought I'd take the chance.
Yes, no. And I'm surprised you didn't get an answer, because it hasn't yet been published, so therefore, obviously, none of us know the detail of that. But we will be looking at it very shortly as a committee. Yeah, indeed. We'll be looking at it. Just one final question, if you don't mind. You mentioned earlier that learners are our main customer, I think. That may not be a direct quote, but it was words to that effect. Can you tell us then, since Education Scotland was formed, or was created, have outcomes for those learners improved?
Outcomes. In our mission statement, we set out an ambition for attainment to rise, excellence, achievement for young people to rise across the Scottish system, and indeed for equity to improve. I think in both cases there is plenty of evidence that overall that is happening in the Scottish education system. I'm sure it's not uniquely down to us, but we are part of, as discussed much earlier, our contribution I believe is positive to that overall improvements in Scottish education. And although there's also some evidence that the equity issue is beginning to shift, but there's a long way to go to get it to where we would all want it to be, I think. So, yes, I think we're on a journey. Yes.
We're on a journey. Well, we're all on a journey.
Yes, indeed.
Mr. Maxwell, thank you very much to both of you for coming along this morning. We appreciate you giving your time to be here with the committee. So thank you very much for that. As the committee has agreed earlier to hold the next items in private, I now close the meeting to the public.